Welcome to the second Stanford Geriatric Education Center webinar on geriatric emergency preparedness and response. My name is Christopher Mottola, and I will be your host for this session. We at the Stanford Geriatric Education Center would like to thank our sponsors, American Geriatric Society, the California Area Health Education Centers, and Natividad Medical Center for their generous support. Their support enables us to disseminate our ethnogeriatric content, extend our reach to a larger network of health professionals, to provide ongoing continuing education, and to expand our use of technology. The preparedness webinar presented today is entitled, Helping Elders at Risk in the Community, Emergency Preparedness and Response from Key Service Providers and Emergency Management. It is co-facilitated by Arlene Johnson, Betty Shields, and Melinda McBride. Dr. Johnson is the director and Dr. Shields is the institutional director of the Ohio Valley Appalachia Regional Geriatric Education Center, a consortium between Louisville, Kentucky, Cincinnati, and East Tennessee State University. Dr. Melinda McBride is an associate director emeriti and ethnogeriatric clinical nurse specialist at Stanford GEC. The second half of the program will feature a panel of speakers composed of Barbara Gordon, Mary J. Bonsudo, Renee Chase, and Patricia L. Duggar. We hope our program today will stimulate ideas you would bring to your institution or agency to enhance the safety of ethnic elders and their families through preparedness programs. If you have questions during the presentation, please use the chat feature on the screen. The presenters will respond to the questions in the Q&A session at the end of their presentations. If you need to communicate with the presenters directly after the session, you may do so by sending an email to stanfordgec@stanford.edu. At the conclusion of the webinar, please complete the short evaluation questionnaire. For those of you who have requested continuing education credits for attending the webinar, the evaluation is required. We need to let you know that the webinar is not supported by any commercial interest, and today's presenters have no financial relationships to disclose. The webinar will start with Melinda McBride and Arlene Johnson's discussion about preparedness, education, and resources. And now for Melinda.
Thank you, Chris, for the introduction, and welcome everyone to our webinar. I would like to share briefly the background of the two emergency preparedness webinars this month. When Homeland Security was created after the 9/11 disaster, the National Association of Geriatric Education Centers initiated a survey of HRSA-funded GECs and found a lack of geriatric curricula and resources on emergency preparedness. NAGEC presented a position statement to HRSA on the need for such training. HRSA's response was to provide supplemental funding for multidisciplinary geriatric emergency preparedness training. Six GECs listed on the slide received support to train health professionals on bioterrorism and emergency preparedness in aging. Later, an all-hazards approach was adopted and the BITEPA group evolved into the Geriatric Emergency Preparedness and Response Collaborative. For the current geriatric education grant cycle, the collaborative proposed to provide more preparedness training, and three GECs from California, Kentucky, and Maine committed to offer training through the SGEC webinar series program. Next year, in 2013, the University of Maine will join us on our webinar emergency preparedness program. So this is our slide, our learning objectives for today. Thank you. We will describe the special functional needs of elders living in the community who receive care from Alzheimer's disease programs, home health agencies, and area agencies on aging, discuss the role of emergency managers, and identify strategies for developing stronger networks in order to meet the needs of at-risk elders in the community, discuss the emergency needs of older, at-risk, ethnic, and minority populations, and identify strategies for helping elders who need to shelter in place to evacuate. These are some of the resources that the Ohio Valley Appalachia region, the OVAR GEC, has developed. And we have links for you here. And I think when you get this, you may need to copy and paste in order to get to the page. And these are the titles of the materials that have, the course materials that have been developed at the OVAR GEC. In addition, the Ohio Valley OVAR GEC was instrumental in developing a document on long-term care planning and resource manual, which was identified in 2010 as a best practice resource material. And there are also resources from the Federal Emergency Management Administration and some fact sheets about the NEMS training courses. OVAR also had preparedness materials on their aging electronic newsletter, and these are also the different sites that you could visit to get the information. Additional resources on long-term care, also accessible through these different sites. The Stanford GEC developed these resources as well, and then we have found resources on the internet related to disaster preparedness as well, and some that are oriented to diversity preparedness. So please consider visiting those sites. And these are additional ethnogeriatric resources developed in other sites. One of these, I think this one in Texas, has information on working with the hearing impaired population. Sometime, I think you received, when you registered, you received an email giving you instructions on how to download handouts. And in that handout, you also have a copy of the case study. And the case study here is to help you follow the presentations and many of this. The scenario here is actually going to be discussed by our panelists. And think about a time when you might have been in this place in March 13, 2012, that there's a series of severe thunderstorms that began in the early morning hours across your area and surrounding communities. And the Weather Bureau forecasts severe weather conditions with lightning, wind gusts of 50 miles per hour, large hail, and growing possibility of tornadoes. The storm will produce rainfall, expecting to cause flooding. A severe thunderstorm warning is in effect. At 10:30 in the morning, a full alert goes out to advise the community to take protective actions and be ready to move to a safe area and take shelter. The downpour continues to threaten the city and surrounding counties. Winds were picking up to 70 miles an hour, and there's considerable debris on the road. The Weather Channel reports about weather situation in your area through the national TV broadcast. People in the state and out of state are beginning to get calls from families and to make sure to find out if they are safe, and the phone networks are jammed. By 5 p.m., the community emergency shelter is filled with isolated seniors, frail elders from the community, persons receiving home health services, and persons with memory disorders, and people who speak, understand little or no English. So we have a pretty intense situation. These are the questions that we had requested that you think about in preparation for this as webinar, that during an emergency of this scale, what would your agency, what would be your agency's primary concern for these populations that are listed here, and what can your agency do to help them? What would your agency do to respond to an emergency warning? And how would your agency locate persons to serve, you serve, that have moved to another location? And we have other questions for you to think about. Would your agency continue to serve your patients, residents, clients at their alternate locations or shelter? And would your agency serve patients, residents, and clients not associated with your agency at alternate locations or shelters? How would your agency work with your county emergency managers to help the persons you serve during the emergency, and what your agency would do when the phones are jammed to confirm and reassure their loved ones that of those who you serve, and what is needed to communicate with persons who speak or understand little or no English to help them be safe? So we now have, we're now ready to have our panel give their presentation, and hopefully with their presentations you'll be able to follow that the information they're going to share are some responses to the questions that I just read off from the slides. And now, and do a quick survey of the participants.
Okay. We're very thankful to have a distinguished panel for this webinar. In the interest of time, I will introduce them briefly. Ms. Barbara Gordon is the Director for the Division of Social Services at the Kentuckiana Regional Planning and Development Agency in Louisville, Kentucky. Ms. Missy Bonsuto is the former regional director and executive director and direct service provider with Almost Family Care Tenders. Ms. Renee Chase is a professional training coordinator with the Alzheimer's Association of Greater Kentucky and Southern Indiana and a chaplain at the University of Kentucky Medical Center. Ms. Patricia Duggar is director of Division of Emergency Management in Lexington, Kentucky. And now we're going to be having a poll. And there's going to be a series of polls throughout the presentation. This is the first one. Wow, so I see we have a large percentage share in education, 17%, and 15% in social services. That's very nice. And there's a large number of you from many different areas. Okay, I'm going to be handing the microphone over to Betty.
All right, I'm thrilled to present Barbara Gordon from the KIPTA Area Agency on Aging and Independent Living agency in Louisville, Kentucky, serving approximately a population of 750,000. And Barbara will take over from now. Thank you.
Good afternoon. It's my pleasure to join you this afternoon to engage in this panel discussion about emergency preparedness and disaster planning, awareness, et cetera. I do serve Louisville in six surrounding counties. It's the KIPTA region, and we serve in the capacity as an Area Agency on Aging and Independent Living and Aging and Disability Resource Center. I have a couple of questions for you. If you would please look to the right of your screen and mark your responses. We want to do that first. We're going to give you a moment to respond, and then Chris will provide me the results of your responses, and then we'll move on into the presentation. Great. I see your responses now, and it appears that 34% of you responded no to the first question, which is your office, senior center, service site, adult day center, et cetera, prepared to shelter in place? And about 17% responded don't know, but 22% responded yes. So that's a good sampling of where we are with understanding the whole notion of sheltering in place. And with the second item, has your agency facilitated educating homebound elders, persons with disabilities, and their caregivers on emergency preparedness and response? I see that there's a higher percentage of folks who responded yes, 34%, with 27% responding no, and about 12% responding that they don't know. There are 27% of you who didn't answer, but that's okay. This just gives me a good feel for some of the information that I'm going to provide to just share our experiences here in Louisville, Kentucky and the surrounding area with disasters. Okay. So where I want to begin is just, again, to let you know a little bit about the type of agency we are. And we're an area agency on aging. And in Kentucky, we are also classified as independent living unit, and we're an aging and disability resource center. And we serve a 7-county area, including Louisville, which is the largest metropolitan area in Kentucky. Now, we're not first responders, but are definitely part of the process of helping the community, and particularly our network to become aware and prepared for disasters that may occur in our geographic area. This can be and was for us a long but worthwhile process. We serve a variety of individuals in our community and particularly vulnerable populations. We primarily serve individuals who live in the community in their own homes or apartments or dwellings, but we also serve a number of individuals in nursing facilities and other residential settings. And the flow of my presentation today is going to take the course of just talking about how our preparedness developed and how the culmination of our preparedness and several incidents that occurred here in Louisville, in our state in particular, in a short period of time, helped us to understand whether we were really prepared, and as well as helped us to understand the fact that you must continue to look at your awareness, your planning, your preparedness, and allow your plans and protocols to evolve with every situation. So prior to the culmination of this series of disasters, our area began a comprehensive overhaul of its own disaster preparedness and response plans and protocols. This began in 2004, and it included a number of functions and activities. And these functions and activities were done at various levels and capacities and included a number of partnerships, and including in the midst of this, partnering with the O of our GEC and their initiatives to help the aging network be better prepared for disasters and emergencies in our state. Our functions and activities included a variety of things, and I'm going to list some of them, not all of them. We changed our disaster and emergency preparedness and response plan significantly. We did a total overhaul of our plan. We included in our protocols a need for training for providers that we work with directly, as well as other partners that we engage, but also our clients. Our clients, the people that we serve, also we identified them as needing training and education. We included in all of our contracts with our providers and partners language that requires each provider to have a disaster and emergency plan. Prior to 2004, this was not a requirement in our contracts, and most of our provider network did not have disaster plans in place. We included in our protocols an ongoing practice of providing homebound clients shelf-stable meals at least twice a year. And we provided all homebound clients at that time, and we'll revisit continuing to enhance and update this particular initiative, emergency kits. We didn't just deliver emergency kits, however. We trained our case managers to take these emergency kits to the homebound clients and to train and educate the homebound client and or their caregiver about what was in the kit, how to keep the kit updated, and when to use the kit. We provided our providers as well with emergency kits and information about sheltering in place, and provided to the senior center participants disaster preparedness training and education, and utilized a video that is specifically designed for older adults. We also provided training to our caregivers in helping them to understand planning for their loved one, especially if they are not with them during disaster. Other training occurred with case managers, planners, providers, and much of our training was done in conjunction with the ORGC, including tabletop demonstrations. We also participated in training and activities with COIN, that is the Kentucky Outreach and Information Network. It's an initiative to connect with providers and individuals throughout our state as it relates to providing information about disasters, about emergencies, as well as providing outreach to a variety of communities, especially those who are vulnerable populations. There are many examples of activities that that we have participated in, and I've shared with you a few of these examples. The next slide is just giving you some pointers about disaster and emergency preparedness. Planning for disaster requires awareness. You have to be aware of the type of disasters, the type of risk that will occur in your area, and the risk percentage in terms of, you know, do you have floods most of the time, tornadoes, etc. But being aware of what type of disasters occur, but not only is the awareness important for you as a provider, as an agency, but it's important for the constituents that you serve. It's important for the provider network that you work with. Being prepared, of course, requires the planning and the initiative to make sure that everyone is trained and educated within your network and within your agency. And having the resources available, make a kit. You know, we emphasize with all of our partners, including the people we serve, that you have to have a kit or some type of resources available to you in a place and in a way that it will be readily available at the time of a disaster. The other thing that we really focused on in our preparedness is making sure that we were connected with the emergency management systems that are in place throughout our state, but particularly in our community, not making sure that we were connected to them, but making sure they are aware of who we are, the resources that we have available, and the assistance that we can provide. As I indicated, we are not first responders, but we definitely have a role to play whenever disasters or emergencies occur within our area. This next slide is just going to show you just a visual of our protocol. I think it'll come up here in a minute, of our protocol in terms of how it functions at the time of a disaster. So anyway, with this particular protocol, we utilize the various functions within our planning system to help us respond to a variety of disasters that occurred in our area. And although we have spent several years of planning and educating and training, we learned a lot through each disaster that we experienced. We were met with many challenges and learned many things that has helped us to enhance our protocols for responding. For the most part, this protocol worked, but we learned so much during these events. It helped us to understand that our protocols and plans are fluid and must continue to evolve and improve. Next slide. So, I talked to you about awareness. Now, I have to admit to you, we didn't talk a lot about hurricanes. during our awareness period in the Louisville area. But as you had noted in that one of the, on my earlier slides, we had the different incidents that we experienced in September of 2008. We literally experienced a hurricane. It was Hurricane Ike. Now, we didn't have all the rain and the thunderstorms, et cetera, but we had the wind of Hurricane Ike to come through our area, and it did an insurmountable amount of damage that created power outages throughout our area. Next slide. You can go through the next to the next one, please. Thank you. Now, what I like to do with these different disasters really quickly is I'm going to just highlight some of the things that we did as a result of our protocols and our response to the disaster, and then identify the areas that are really important for us to develop or to improve our planning. And because I only have 5 more minutes, I'm not going to talk a whole lot about each of these, but I want you to look at some of our response areas for each of the slides that I'm going to click through next. The next slide, please. What went well for our response included the fact that KIPTA itself as an agency did not lose power. You'll see when we get to the next incident that that wasn't the case, and we really had to reflect on that. The other thing that went well for us during the windstorm had to do with our staff being available for immediate response to the individuals in our area, as well as our provider network. Now, some of the things that did not go well, next slide, included our continuity of operations had to be improved as a result of the windstorm, because even though our office was able to remain open because they did not lose power, 50% of our staff did lose power, and many of them had children out of school during that time, and we did not have the resources. We had limited manpower to fully implement our protocol to do some of the door-to-door visits that we would normally do to check on individuals out in our area. Next slide. Now, the next two slides just show you some pictures, next one, of the ice storm. The ice storm was the next incident that occurred within just a few months of the windstorm. Now, this ice storm, although it impacted our area significantly, it impacted the entire state. It was a statewide disaster for the most part. This slide will show you some of the numbers in terms of people impacted in our 7-county area. Next slide. However, in the state, more than 700,000 people were impacted. 80% of all of our staff were impacted by this particular disaster, so you can see how that continuity of operations plan was really critical for this particular disaster, and it's a good thing that the windstorm occurred so that we had the opportunity to take a look at it and to improve it. Because of our focus on weaknesses before, it helped our response in this particular situation. Next slide. And this response came from the community and the government, as well as our agency. Go on to the next slide, please. And one of the things that we learned from the previous windstorm were some issues that revolved around shelters and special needs shelters. So due to that experience, for the ice storm, special needs shelters were identified as a great need, and the Red Cross as well as community action agencies in the rural counties responded by opening up and providing manpower and public health services for special needs populations. Next slide. And what went well really was the community and the government were prepared for immediate response and learned from responses during the windstorm. And there were very few deaths during the ice storm in our particular region, where there were several deaths across the state, but in our region there were very few deaths. Next slide. There were some challenges during the ice storm. Icy conditions impacted the ability of staff and providers to immediately check on the elderly. And due to the continued damages to power, transformers, long-term care facilities were impacted for an extended period of time. So this was a more long-term event, than the previous windstorm. The other thing that I want to highlight about this particular event is that we did have some issues with shelters. One of the things that we know is that we need to do more education for clients and caregivers about what to take to shelters, what to bring to shelters, et cetera. And then the other caveat is that we've got to work on figuring out a way for especially our older adults to bring their pets to shelters or to have their pets close by. That was a particular concern for many of our homebound elders who did not want to leave their homes without power in sub-degree weather because they didn't want to leave their pets. They didn't want to separate from their pets. Next slide. This just identified some of the challenges again. The 14 days total of no power. There were a number of new challenges identified. We know we need more education. Next slide. In the midst of this, and we're going to go through this really quickly, and I know I'm talking fast, but we did have the pandemic to slip up in our area in the midst of all of these different events. And we did actually have some H1N1 incidents in our area and utilized our protocols to help us deal with them. We had actually had some pandemic emergency training that was provided for us through the OVRGC, and thank goodness we had it prior to this particular incident so that it really did help us. The next disaster that I'm going to cover very quickly, next slide, is the freaky flood, and that's what I call it. The record-breaking heavy rains fell in Jefferson County, Kentucky, as well as Floyd and Clark counties in Indiana, in 2009, in August of 2009, through strong thunderstorms, and it was very bizarre the way this rain fell. 6 inches fell between 7 and 10 a.m., especially in central Louisville. 5 inches of rain fell in 90 minutes from 7:45 to 9:15, and rain rates up to an astounding 8.8 inches per hour were reported. Nearly 200 people were rescued by emergency workers from tops of cars and houses. About 50 people were rescued by boat from a University of Louisville administrative office building. 2 children were pulled from swelling creeks. Water was reported to be several feet deep in parts of Louisville. Cars were submerged in a downtown parking lot. Next slide. After flooding affected Churchill Downs and I-64 and 264. Were closed. So you can see how this was a major event. Over 15,000 homes were affected, and a number of these homes were in the lower socioeconomic area in our city. Over $25 million in damages occurred. Next slide. So it was a unique event, but it impacted our community significantly. Now, the response was very what I described. First responders, of course, responded initially to the crisis situations, but there were a variety of community partners, local, state, and federal government who came together in a multifaceted effort to help our community as a result of this particular disaster, including volunteer groups and people from other states. Next slide. The August 4th flood required a specific type of response, but one of the caveats of this particular disaster had to do with the long-term nature of it. And a long-term recovery team was reestablished as a result of this particular incident. And KIPTA, as an area agency on aging, served on that team and had a staff trained as caseworkers to work with individuals to help them in a number of areas. Next slide. There were a number of things that were needed as a result of this particular incident, including working with families and individuals one-on-one to help them navigate the system, to work with FEMA, to find other resources when FEMA was not available for their damage. And the situation required that type of involved casework. And believe it or not, the last case was closed in 2011 as a result of that particular incident. My last slide is just one to give an overview of what experiencing all of these major disasters plus H1N1 within a one-year period of time does. It teaches you lessons. And the most powerful lesson it teaches is that the learning process in terms of how to prepare and respond to disasters never end. Communicating before the event is critical. It was good that we had all the planning and preparedness that we did prior to these incidents, but if we had not, the response could have been a lot different and probably would have resulted in a negative way, even more so than what we experienced. And establishing partnerships and protocols is essential in disaster preparedness and response. Thank you for your time. There will be an opportunity to ask questions later. I'm going to give the mic over to Missy at this time, and she's going to begin her presentation.
Hello, everyone. My name is Missy Bonsudo, and I've been doing home care for over 20 years, and I'm on the board with the Kentucky Home Care Association. Part of our goal is that we serve agencies across the state of Kentucky for both skilled home health and home care agencies. And as I talk through my presentation, I'm going to hopefully provide some information to you all on what that might look like if you were coming across a patient that would be served by us. Before I start, we do have a question for you on the right side of your screen, polling question. So we have our responses here. Looks like 31% of you answered no to the question, do you have a written plan for locating, providing care to your patients or clients who move to another location? 13% said yes, 10% said I don't know, and 46% didn't answer the question. If we can switch to the back to the presentation. So just to give you an idea about some age distribution of patients who are seen in the home care arena, and if we're talking about the elderly here, you can see that about 18% are actually over 85 years of age, and as you probably know, the number of people living over 85 is growing by the minute, one of the fastest growing population age groups that we have, 25% in the 75 to 84%, 26%, 21% in the 65 to 74. So if you look at the over 65 population, that is 65% of it. Now, because in order to receive home care, whether it's personal care needs or skilled home health care, you're obviously going to have some kind of requirements for assistance with activities of daily living. Refer to activities of daily living as bathing, dressing, grooming, or independent activities of daily living, getting your meals, and some of those other things that are not personal care needs, but that you need to be able to function independently in your home. So another 25% of the age distribution may not be elderly in age, but from a standpoint of their physical ability, they do have a lot of chronic illnesses and issues with mobility and being able to take care of their own personal care needs. So talking about who a patient for home care might be and where you might find them if you're going to participate in disaster recovery and emergency management, the definition of a home care patient is someone who lives in a personal residence, which sounds pretty simple, but that's not always the case. From a technical standpoint, for skilled home care, which would be the needs of having a nurse or a therapist there, it's any place someone would be residing that's not a nursing home or a hospital. So those kinds of facilities, you're not going to find home care patients, although in some of those facilities, you actually will maybe find some private duty aides or somebody who's sitting that someone's private paying to stay with mom because there's not somebody in the room all the time. But we see patients who are not only living in their own homes, but living in independent living, senior high-rise centers, HUD buildings, home care patients. We serve a lot of home care patients in HUD housing as well as in assisted living facilities. And the requirements for assisted living facilities and receiving home care in those does vary from state to state. And some of those services are in the definitions of ALF requirements from a state standpoint. Some of them can get some sort of a la carte skilled care, some cannot. But there would certainly be an opportunity for that. There's also some misconception on home health patients sometimes, or whether or not that they have to have a caregiver actually in the home. There is no requirement that there's a caregiver in the home living with them, unless it would be that they could not call 911 if there was a fire or something like that. So you could have someone who is actually chair-bound who was living alone in the home, and that's really important if you're going to go in from an emergency standpoint to not have the impression that if I'm going to look for someone that they're all going to be able to ambulate, as long as they had a cognitive status that they would know if they could call 911 to get help. From a socioeconomic standpoint, we have people who also have private pay 24-hour caregivers staying with people. I've cared and seen people who are an ALS patient who's living at home on a ventilator with 24-hour care and someone staying with them. Two people are having short-term recovery. A lot of the elderly are requiring knee replacement or hip replacement surgery, and will get some home care services. So they have a very short time period that they're receiving skilled care, and their recovery period is very quick, but they could go from not being able to ambulate up and down the stairs at all to within a couple of weeks be able to be back independent. And we spoke a little bit about the level of mobility, and we're going to talk about some of the devices that might be in the home, as well as language differences. If an agency cares for a population that maybe there's a large Russian population in the community, there may be Russian-speaking nurses and therapists that an agency may employ. If they don't have those kinds of opportunities, then in order to service those patients, they would be able to have someone who is English as a second language or as a primary language. Like a lot of times we'll have grandchildren who are living in the home with someone who doesn't speak English, and we use those as interpreters, as well as working with the different universities and things for a telephone provider. So when we're there, they can get on the phone and they can do a telephone interpretation. So those are some of the different avenues for looking at language differences in trying to communicate and serve that population. I believe most home care providers these days do have a second group of information, patient information or whatever, that does have Spanish. That's pretty readily available. So what kind of services would you be expected that might be needed if you were going to go find someone, either you were vacating them from their home or they were coming to a shelter that you were working with? Skilled home care service providers would be providing some kind of nursing care, and that would include that they've got a new disease process and they're trying to learn to deal with it, to managing their medications, the multiple medications that these elderly on sometimes is just astounding. And so just making sure that one healthcare provider hasn't ordered a medication that's a duplicate to another one when they go from one facility to another. So, and you will find when you go into people's homes that sometimes they will have bags of medications and they'll keep them in alternate locations. If they're receiving skilled home care, we really try to get them to keep all of their medications in one place. Although if it's something that they need on an as-needed basis, like a pain medication, that might be in their drawer in their bedroom, something like that. So if you're going to go and evacuate someone, you're going to want to ask them where they are. Every home care provider that I know leaves some kind of folder in the home. There's a folder with the agency name on it. A lot of times there's a magnet on the refrigerator. That's another good place to go to see if they have some sort of home care agency. And if they're receiving skilled care services, and I believe in most of the personal care home care services as well, there's a list of their medications. So being able to bring that with them if they're sheltering, if they're going to shelter in another environment, to make sure that you get that if you're helping to evacuate someone. There usually will be enough supplies if there is a wound that needs to be changed and cared for a period of 1 week. So
If you know that someone has some sort of wound, there's usually a bag or a box of supplies to grab those. So if we're looking in an emergency, and usually they're short term, you'll at least be able to get enough supplies for whoever needs to do that care in wherever they're going. We have patients with cardiac conditions, so you'll need to make sure if they've got any medicines they need for angina or those sorts of things. Lots of rehabilitative patients, so assistive devices, and we're going to talk about some equipment in a minute. We do have social workers. Almost every certified skilled home health agency will employ social services. So those services would really be go into place when if we had a disaster and work with things like loss and grief and trying to hook up agencies. So we want to make sure that that's available. And as long as we get a order from a physician, we can add those services if it wasn't currently at that point. We do have lots of personal care aides within a skilled facility as well as the home care personal care. That's really the bulk of what they're doing. And then coordinating care. So dealing in an unfamiliar environment or not having the ideal conditions is something that home care is kind of used to because everyone home is different. I always say in my years that there's no bedside table in a home, so we're not used to working in ideal conditions. Just to give you an idea about some of the equipment that you might see in the home, if you have someone that has mobility issues, you want to try to see if they do have a specialty, a mattress or a cushion so that we don't get in worse shape. One of the things is also some of these machines that they may have removable plugs. So if you're going to go and remove someone, sometimes the cord will come off the back. Make sure you've got all the parts and pieces if we're going to have electricity where we're going. Also oxygen, if they have oxygen in the home and they have concentrators. They're also going to have O2 tanks for portability from that standpoint. If you have a ventilator in the home, they will have an AMBU bag. They always have one there so that someone can ventilate if you need to. So what can we do or how can home health help in emergency situations and what do home care providers generally have? One would be an agency emergency management plan, and that is a very detailed discussion about who's to call who. All of the patients are divided into areas, and so there's always an emergency management plan for communicating because we're not all in the same building anyway. Also, there's a hazard vulnerability assessment, and Barbara was discussing the types of disasters and risks, and your hazard vulnerability assessment exactly does that. What are you going to see, and maybe in Kentucky we deal with a lot of thunderstorms, a lot of power outages and those sorts of things, and so putting that into place is very we're very used to that. Even have agencies that have generators in their buildings because they're used to the power going out. And every patient is prioritized, and are they going to need to be seen in 24 hours, 2 to 3 days, or 3 to 5 days? So when an emergency does come about, we know that. Our responsibility to our patients is that we communicate that prioritization at admission and let them know based on where they are that they will not expect us to show up immediately. Like Barbara mentioned, in home care you're not going to be a first responder, but we will contact them, try to find out where they're going and follow up. And if they're in your building and they come in or sheltering somewhere else and you have patients who don't have home care, we can see people in the general area. We can see other patients if they need care as long as we have a physician's order. So if you are setting up a plan and you have your health department physician and he's willing to give us orders, then we can go and help. Most of your states will have a list of providers in your area, and I would suggest that you have that in part of your plan, that you keep that list, you know who they are, and probably also find the key providers, your administrators, your executive directors, in case they're not answering the phone in the office, but maybe you can get through on the cell phone. So I hope that has given you some information related to home care. And I am now going to give this back to Chris and Betty.
All right, so you will see the questions there in the right-hand side of your screen, and if you can go ahead and get those taken care of, looks like that already has happened. So for question one and two, if you could go ahead and choose your answers and submit those. Okay, it looks like the poll has ended. Okay, now we're looking at some survey results, and that kind of lets me know where you are. And looks like for the most part, just a few of you have the written plans to meet physical, emotional, and cognitive needs. And it looks like a few of you do have some training in place for your staff and volunteers. Well, I would like to stress that the two primary things you're going to deal with someone who has dementia is communication and dealing with their physical environment. Whenever someone has impaired processing, their response to disasters is going to be more aggravated. They're going to be more sensitive to trauma. They're going to have that limited ability to understand directions. One of the problems you're going to run into with people is, especially if you have people who have English as a second language, dementia causes people's cognitive and speech abilities to go down anyway, and then whenever you have someone who does not speak English as a native language, then they're going to be relying more and more on their native language. If you don't have people around who speak their native language, then you're going to have to think about ways to communicate with them that aren't necessarily verbal. Even in their native language, people lose the ability to communicate effectively and to perceive what it is that you're saying. So they have that limited ability to understand directions. They may forget instructions. And because of the communication problems, you're going to find that they become more easily agitated, frustrated. And whenever people find themselves in that difficult situation where there's a lot of activity and unfamiliar surroundings, they're going to be prone to wander or hide. Now, if you have a family member present with that person, they're going to be able to mitigate quite a bit of that. But if you have someone who comes into a shelter or into a place where they are not in their familiar surroundings, you may have to assign someone to stay with them in a one-on-one setting. Now, during an evacuation, do not leave the person alone. That's where the wandering, where they try to hide, because they're trying to find a safe place to escape all the chaotic events going on around them. If you find someone that you do have to shelter for more than a few hours, that change in routine and environment is going to aggravate a lot of the behavioral symptoms. They're going to become more agitated. They're going to wander. You'll find them moving from place to place in a specific setting, in a shelter setting, or wherever they are, and they are not going to be able to focus on what it is that you would like for them to do. You're also going to see an increase in their behavioral symptoms. They're going to hallucinate more. They're going to have more delusions. They're also going to have more sleep disturbances. This is because they are in an unfamiliar surrounding, and they're trying to make sense of it, but because of the cognitive impairments, they're unable to do that effectively. The best thing you can do is to set the tone for them and to remain calm. Keeping them calm and keeping yourself calm is the way to make a more effective evacuation with them. Now, if you do find someone who is agitated, find outlets for that energy. Try to get them to help you do a simple task or to help someone on your staff or volunteers to do maybe fold towels or hand out things. And give them a way to feel like they're being useful. People still need to feel useful. Redirect their attention if they become upset. Try to keep them in a more quiet place. Whenever people are getting settled into in a regular shelter setting, or maybe it's even in a hospital or just a gathering place, there's a lot of activity and a lot of commotion, and that really agitates someone because they go into sensory overload. Try to move them to a quieter space, limit that stimulation. If they are on medications, which most folks with dementia have some form of medication they take, make sure they take it as scheduled, because the last thing you want to do is have them off schedule and find that their behavioral issues, their cognitive problems increase due to the lack of proper medication schedules and the environmental changes. Try to keep regular meals, maintain a regular sleep schedule. I think that's a great idea for everybody, but especially for someone with dementia, because they can have that sense of order that they need in order to function more effectively. Whenever you're communicating with someone, keep your statements short and simple. Use brief explanations. Instead of giving them a multi-part explanation of what you want them to do or what's going to happen, just give them one chunk of information at a time and always say the same thing the same way every time. So if you want someone to move from the main area where you have a group of people, then you can just simply say, Mr. Johnson, let's move over here to the side room. Mr. Johnson, let's move over here to this side room. And whenever you say the same thing the same way, it allows them to continue to process what you are telling them, because their brains are not able to process as quickly as someone who's cognitively intact. So they just simply need more time. Also, be prepared to help folks with their ADLs, especially if they do not have family members present. They may need help dressing. They may need help grooming. They may need their food set up for them. Because you're going to run into people who even still live alone and do begin to need help with their ADLs. So be ready to have staff who is able to help out with that and to be able to give extra time to these folks who have higher needs. Pay attention to their cues about overwhelming. You may see fidgeting or pacing. You may see them retreat into a corner, even put their hands over their ears. You begin to see them maybe picking up objects and setting them down or just getting into things because they're not quite sure what to do. So they're getting overwhelmed. There's too much information. There's too much going on. A lot of times you'll have people who want to go home, but remind them that they're in the right place. And if they do not have family with them, reassure them your family will come and find you. It will be okay. Why don't you stay here with me and we'll fold towels or we can help people pass out their care kits or whatever it is that you have that they can help you with. Because the idea is that you want to keep them to where they feel like they're busy and where they feel like they're doing something meaningful, because they don't have the ability to just simply sit and wait patiently. That's not something they're capable of. During an episode, approach from the front and use his or her name. Use calm, positive statements. When you speak to them, use a more low-pitched voice, very calm. People with hearing loss tend to not hear the higher registers anyway. So always approach them from the front. You sure don't want to come up behind somebody because they will startle and that could cause a behavioral issue and you could end up getting hit or just simply them going off. Respond to their emotions. Whenever they say, I want to go home, often they're saying, I don't feel safe or I need to feel like this is an okay place for me to be. Acknowledge the fear or the anger or whatever other emotion they're feeling and validate that, and that will actually help to calm them whenever they feel like they're being heard and whenever you can name what it is that they're experiencing. Finally, don't argue with them. It won't work. You cannot argue with a person who has dementia. And the reason why is because your reality and their reality are not the same thing. When you try to correct someone who has dementia, maybe they're convinced that they've got to go home and take care of their children. You can't tell them, well, your children are all grown and live in another city. They're not going to listen to that. So instead of trying to argue or correct them, try to divert their attention. Help them to find another outlet. Try to get them to tell you stories about maybe where they grew up. A great thing to do whenever you want to move someone off of something is just simply say, well, tell me where you grew up. And folks at that point, in the middle and early stages, they can often continue to tell you those stories of whenever they were much younger. And it's a great diversion to have because they quite often do like to tell stories. So get them to tell stories. Ask them what they did for a living. Ask them what really wonderful places they've ever traveled to. So even if you don't have a family member there, you can get them talking about their stories, and that will get them off of some of the other fixations that they may have. Now, here's a list of resources that we have used before. The Calm Before the Storm, that's a wonderful guide for helping families prepare. I would suggest for professionals to take a look at the AOA site. That's a really great site where it addresses sheltering and things like that. And then Planning for a Pandemic or Disaster. That is from our website with the Alzheimer's Association, and it deals not just with sheltering, but with how to prepare for disease situations and other sorts of disasters, both natural, man-made, that could come up and affect the person with dementia. So I believe that I am going to pass this off to Pat, and I hope you all have a wonderful day, and she'll be.
Okay, this is Pat, and I think we also have a few polling questions off to your right. Looks like they just came up, so if you'll just take a second to answer those questions, that would be great. And while you're working on that, I'll tell you just a little bit. Here in Lexington, Kentucky, we've had the fortunate, I guess, ability from my perspective to have experienced ice storms, snowstorms, tornadoes, a plane crash, relocation of folks. So we've had a lot of experience in dealing with disasters and relocation. We're also part of the chemical stockpile program with the 8 sites across the country that had nerve agents stored, and we have a lot of experience in planning on actually receiving quite a few folks from an adjoining community. So being prepared for an influx of people or for people in a different situation is something that we've had a lot of time to look at and plan for and to evaluate exercises and things with. Looks like the poll has ended, and boy, it's really close, 28%, 28%, and 43% on about having a family or a written plan. And then your agency, it looks like we have 28% of a yes, which is good that a lot of people have, and then a 46% no answer. So it's good. It's a good place to start. And we'll kind of roll right into the presentation so that we make the best of time. But one thing I'd like to emphasize is it's hard to promote having preparedness and a family plan and a disaster plan to others if you yourself don't have one. So I'd like to challenge all of you all to go out there and develop your own family and plan and get more involved in your community disaster plan. One of the things that's always good to know is, where are your elders? And I know that they're in your community, but do you know specifically where they are? Do you know if they're mobile or not mobile? Do they live alone or with someone? And what generation are they? Are they mostly young elders, 60s, 70s, or are they older, 80 or 90? So, and are they culturally diverse, impaired? So it's really good to get an idea of the identity of the elder community in your population that you have. And two of the things that I think that is good to note is that they really are everywhere. You'll learn once you learn a whole lot about your community. They're going to obviously be out in the general population. They're going to be in all kinds of healthcare facilities, from hospitals, nursing homes, assisted livings, also in institutions. A lot of us have local jails, federal and state prisons in our communities, and a lot of those are elderly population that we can't forget about and we want to include. Some of these folks are in a system somewhere of some sort, being looked at by healthcare or service providers, but a lot of them actually live alone. We had an ice storm here in Lexington in 2003, and actually I was very taken back at the amount of elders that were out there, not in any system, living alone, doing just dandy until they were in a different situation for 2, 3, 4, up to 8 days without a lot of the services they were used to, without electricity. And then they had a lot of needs. So it's really good to find them. And for all of you, I'd like to ask you to get involved as service providers with your local emergency management agency. It takes a village to raise a child, but it also takes a village definitely to prepare a community and individuals to be ready for any disaster. And the more folks involved in that planning process, obviously the better you're going to be, the more resilient you're going to be at getting individuals, families, and the whole community back together. So, you know, look at all the ways you can find your elders. The census is a good way. Schools, faith-based groups, volunteers, senior centers. There's just lots of ways to find the population. And I kind of like to say, don't leave any stone unturned. Really look out there and find them. And the better that you have an assessment of where they are, the better you can plan to help that population. A couple things that I like to look at when we're dealing with any population group really is the personal responsibility of being emergency prepared for the individual or the family, and then the community side of that. And the personal one is have a plan. You know, have a family plan, an emergency or an individual plan. Make a kit and be aware. And a lot of things that some of the previous speakers have mentioned is it's all kits and plans are individual to that family. Some people have children, some people have pets, some people have other things, a cane or a wheelchair or other things. So you really have to make that plan and that kit specific and tailored to you. There's some basic things you want to have, you know, a little bit of food, you know, a battery-operated weather radio, but you also want to make it very specific. And do some assessment of your needs and helping them to assess the needs that they may have as service providers when you go in their home. How could they access or exit the facility, whether it's individual home or another building, if things are blocked in their mobility? Do they have service animals? Do they know individually how to cut off utilities, or does the building know how to do that, the facility people? How do you deal with communication within the building or if there's lack of interpreters? I mean, there's just lots of issues to think about with the elderly, especially if they're cognitively or physically impaired. So you want to really do an assessment of their own facilities, their own abilities, and then ask them, how would that change if there were, you know, things were different and you didn't have all the things you were used to? On the community side of preparedness, you know, one of the things that you're doing when you find the elders and you learn more about them is you're determining the needs that you have to have as a community to be prepared to help assist this population get, you know, back together as quickly as possible. And then once you kind of figure out what your needs are, you try to determine as a community what the capabilities are. I mean, one of the things, again, that we learned in the 2003 ice storm here was that we really didn't have a good capability to do sheltering for the elderly and for the cognitively, physically impaired. So we set about developing that capability, and now we have the capability to do a special medical needs shelter. And one of the things we try to do here, as Renee had talked about, is having the family with someone with dementia. Well, what we try to do is co-locate the general population, like a Red Cross shelter, and the special medical needs, so the family can stay intact as a whole. Because a lot of times in the Red Cross sheltering, they don't have the capability to offer some of the services that a medical needs shelter would do. So we're trying to do that so families can stay together and it's a little more calming for those. So if you determine your capabilities like we did, you try to figure out how you're going to lessen those gaps between the needs and capabilities. And trust me, you'll never make it zero. It's just impossible. There's just not enough people, time, and resources to be able to do that. And that's why in the needs that you're looking at, you figure out what's your greatest risk, what do you have the most of, and then you kind of go from there. Some of the other things just in personal preparedness that you can help have folks look at when you're in their homes or doing service providers, one is certainly to be an advocate for them to get prepared personally. Help them look at what systems they rely on now and how they could adjust and be self-sufficient if those systems weren't available or if they didn't work or if they couldn't adjust, then what are they going to need in place of that? You know, ask them what is their greatest fear or concern during an emergency, what are they most worried about, and then try to give them assistance either by resources or other ways that they can address those concerns and fears so they will be a little more self-sufficient. Help them to do a self-capability assessment, you know, making sure they have extra batteries or extra oxygen or ways to get those things, that they have the 3-day to 7-day supply of medicine. Do they need special food, and should they keep some of that on hand if they had to evacuate or leave their facilities? How would they maneuver? You know, can your wheelchair go over, you know, cracked glass and a little bit of small lumber to get out of the building? Or if that happens, are, you know, do you need additional assistance to get out? You know, does the building they live in have an evacuation plan, and do they know what that is and how it would work? I think Renee had talked about, you know, having cards and things like that that you could hand to a provider. So if you couldn't communicate in a language, that's certainly something else to think about. And we try to provide those to our responders here so that the responders can talk to people with little picture cards or other things like that if there's not a way to do that. On the community side, a little bit more in detail, is definitely have a planning group. And as I said earlier, involve all disciplines that you can think of that have a perspective and have interest and knowledge of the elderly and those situations so that you can get different perspectives. You can't do this in a vacuum. You can't sit, you know, in a behind a desk and write the plan and expect it to work. It's just not going to happen that way. Test and try evacuation of facilities and institutions. We were fortunate here just last month to have an exercise where we provided training at first for hospitals to use some evacuation equipment, and then we actually let them exercise and practice in that. And that's not something you do every day, and so it gives you a little bit of comfort to know, hey, I know how to do this in case it happens. I'm not quick reading out a quick note to say push A, B, and C. I've actually done it. You know, do you have the capability as a community of sheltering the elders and all the issues that are involved with that? You know, make sure that you're acquiring the proper equipment and supplies. And another thing like we're doing here today, I think it's just so important to train responders and service providers on the information about the community plan, about the elderly, and give them some input and insight into what those needs are. And then kind of like with any good plan, you really have to practice, exercise, and review. Practice does not make perfect in this, but it sure helps you find some of the ways that you can improve, and then review that. We're very strong here in Lexington about reviewing our exercises and real events and learning from them and making changes in whether it's equipment, policies, practices, or whatever, or bringing more people to the table that we learn about that have some great knowledge that would be a good factor in the plan. And then there's just a few resources that I provided. There's really a lot out there. The FEMA.gov Are You Ready site has a lot of really good information. CDC has a lot of good information. They have a brand new report out identifying vulnerable older adults and legal options for increasing their protection during all hazard emergencies. It's a real good report that has just come out. You have my email and phone number, and most of your local Red Cross and emergency management agencies would love to hear from you and get you involved in the planning process and working together on all these kinds of issues. It's amazing how much we cross over in what we do and don't realize it until we start talking and planning. So I think I'm going to pass this on, and I appreciate the opportunity to talk with you today, and I'm going to pass it on.
Quick questions 9 and 10. As a result of this webinar, will you create your own individual or family written plan? And question number 2, as a result of this webinar, do you have recommendations that you're likely to make to improve your agency's plan? All right, the results are in. 53% of you said that this webinar is triggering you to create your own individual and family written plan. That's fantastic. That's a terrific outcome. And then as a result of the webinar, 43% of you are going to have recommendations to make to improve your agency's plan. And again, that's a wonderful outcome of the webinar. We can't ever update our plans too often, and it always pays to review them with our family as well as our agency.
Thank you, everyone. We now have some time for the presenters to answer your questions. If you have any questions, please use the chat feature, which is located on the lower right side of your screen.
Okay, Malin has asked a question. Is there a resource like a preparedness registry for elders with special needs? Any of our participants have a response?
This is Pat, and a lot of that is community specific. I know that there's several communities here in Kentucky that have a registry, but it's not everywhere, and there's not a national registry. So it really just depends on the community.
Yes, this is Barbara, and I agree. I was going to say the same thing, that there had been attempts even in Kentucky through COIN, the Kentucky Outreach and Information Network, to try to assimilate some type of registry, but it you know, meets with these issues in a number of ways. But I do believe that there are still some national initiatives as well to try to facilitate developing some type of system.
And a lot of those are starting to initiate through 911 as well, where they can capture some of that information right there in the 911 database. So there's some of those out there as well.
Right. I believe there's a question, what is a good shelter environment for people with dementia? Is someone prepared to respond to that?
Hi, this is Renee. Whenever you think about setting up a shelter environment, some of the things to think about are the physical environment. You want to minimize clutter for the floor space. You want to also make sure that you have a bright but not harsh light because of the visual issues. Another visual issue to think about is you don't want a floor with varied light and dark patterns, because a dark space in the floor looks like a hole to someone who is in the later part of the early stages and on through the middle stages of dementia. And that, of course, causes a fall risk. Also keep them away from the building traffic and from noise as much as possible to minimize agitation. And when you're there, also make sure you have some things for activity, whether there's a family member there or not. Have boxes of old hats, have old ties, have magazines and pictures that can be conversation starters or ways to distract them whenever they do become agitated. Something else that's really important for all stages of dementia is music. Now, it sounds kind of funny for emergency preparedness, why do I need to bring music and ties? But the goal is to keep them as calm as possible, and so that you can minimize those behaviors. Now, back to music, that's really important because that's a piece that people can link back into at any stage of the disease. They respond really well to it, but make sure you have it from different decades so that there's something there that they can really connect with. If it's someone who is from a culture that's not specifically Euro-American, then have some of the more ethnic music that they would be able to connect with. It's a wonderful way to get people to kind of stop and calm down and make sure that they're not hurting themselves or wandering off or getting themselves in a dangerous situation.
This is Betty.
Thank you. The question is, I work for a municipality which has a very eager emergency management department that wants our office to get the word out to residents about emergency preparedness, I guess. It's a very hard sell to get residents to come to this type of program. We even have starter kits. Any suggestions? neighborhood watch group, block watch groups are a good way to do it. Working through your faith-based organizations and community centers are a good way to do it. Also, working with your emergency manager and the Department of Public Health in creating CERT teams, which are citizen emergency response teams. They provide excellent training, and neighborhoods can learn how to check on each other's safety, how to turn off the gas lines to their own house as well as other people's houses, how to assist with even some search and rescue. These trainings are applicable for even seniors. We have limited physical abilities but want to participate. Assisted living facilities have actually created some of these search teams so they can work with each other, as well as some of the HUD-funded multifamily units. So I guess one of my recommendations is start local and start at the neighborhood level if you can. Try and create an advisory group representing numerous representatives and leaders from across the spectrum in the community and build out from there. Even having school groups offer that kind of training can be helpful. Anybody else have comments on that? Missy does.
This is Missy. I agree with Betty. Also, she was talking about assisted livings, HUD buildings, those kinds of things are always looking for programs, and you can coordinate with the home care agencies in your area. If you have information that you want to pass out, if it's not vendor related, which this is obviously not, they're glad to you know, as they go out and see people, put that information in their packets. That's really good. Also, another way to get that out, if you're like wanting people to know about that you have a kit related to making a personal kit, would be if you have someone who delivers meals to their home. You can put flyers on top of the meals, and the people delivering the meals will communicate that. So those are all different ways, as well as in most of the buildings, ALFs, ILers, ILs, or HUD buildings, they're looking for monthly programs, and so your home care agencies could work on how are we going to work with that and do a program of some type and coordinate with you all to offer those things. Then you can get somebody to have a light snack and something. I always say if you feed them, they will come. So that's a good opportunity if you can team with someone who would sponsor your event in a community. And Barbara has a comment.
This is Pat. If I could just add one quick thing to that, there are two other things that you might think about is do a public safety fair. People will always come and see fire trucks and police trucks, and emergency management likes to be able to take advantage of that and be there with that. So some sort of fair that's going to draw the public out, and then you can be there and be a part of that. The second thing is through the schools. The schools are a great way to get out to the public, and what kids bring home, they make sure their parents pay attention to. So there's two other ways, the school system and then just on a public fair might be another way that you could do something like that.
There's another comment on the chat that says, how about consider a contest for agencies to have and develop starter kits within a period of time. The only other comment I would make, those were all wonderful suggestions and great comments, is for your older adults and vulnerable populations, a lot of times you may be able to partner with the area agency on aging in your community because they do have connections with a number of providers, a huge provider network, including senior centers, as well as the home delivered meal providers within the communities, and can really help you network with those particular families, including caregivers, people who are taking care of older adults. And then many of the area agencies on aging across the country also administer the long-term care ombudsman program, where you might be able to also facilitate some connections with your nursing facilities.
Thank you so much. This is Chris Mottola at the Stanford GEC. This concludes our presentation today on helping elders at risk in the community, emergency preparedness and response from key service providers and emergency management. I'd like to thank the presenters, Drs. Arlene Johnson, Betty Shields, and Melinda McBride, Barbara Gordon, Mary J. Bonsudo, Renee Chase, and Patricia L. Duggar. Thank you so much for your participation. If you enjoyed this presentation, please be aware that completion of the survey allows us to continue to get funding. Our next webinar will be on Thursday, July 19th, 12 p.m. to 1 p.m. Pacific Time. It will be on pain management in diverse older adults and given by Dr. Ann Hughes. Thank you very, very much.